Hey everybody, it's Stephanie Old World Gamer along with Scott Devin Kane.
And welcome back to more Indie Pixels Podcast.
We're back here for another week of gaming news and adventure and potentially things you might not have known.
Indeed, lots of fun stuffs. So,
I don't mean to interrupt our intro or anything like that, but before we start, on the first article that I'm on right now, off to the right side, there's a little button that says exercise gaming hacks.
Wait, what?
Now, doesn't this defeat the purpose of an exercise game when you cheat? I think that's called going out and getting a hot dog.
Right?
That's an exercise gaming hack. That's how you cheat in an exercise game.
Eating a bag of chips while someone else does it.
Cheater!
Jesus.
I had to mention that because I'm like, exercise gaming hacks? It's like, what?
Unless you're saying exercise gaming hacks. Like, use them. Exercise your right to... I don't know. Either way, it sounds fucking
I have no idea. Anyway.
Get to your news, sir. We will start your news.
Yes, sir. So, I don't like to admit that I'm wrong. Simply because when I say things, I like knowing what I'm talking about, and I like being right. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
I understand that.
So, I might have been wrong about something. And it might have been the new Doom game. Now, a couple of weeks back, we did, you know, I told you guys about, you know, they did the Doom trailers, and I was like, oh, I don't like how the melee system is, and blah, 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 and all that crap. And so, recently, the newest trailer for Doom has introduced something to us called glory kills. Okay? And basically what the glory kills are is all the melee crap that you saw in the original trailer. Idea goes like this. You use your weaponry to down a zombie or an imp or what like that or whatnot. And then you input a command that makes a glory kill happen. So like an animation of killing something. So like you shoot an imp with a shotgun and he goes down and there's like a little flash that goes over them, like a little digital flash that goes over, you know, whoever you're shooting. And if you, you know, go through with doing a glory kill, which is basically like, you know, just over the top animation, like you may, you know, beat his face in or curb stomp him or something like that.
A la, you know, like fucking Manhunt.
Yeah, stuff like that. You get, you know, extra health. Okay. Now, I have sung the praises of this Doom mod that I play called Brutal Doom.
Okay? Yeah, yep.
And
I've heard a lot of people play that.
The idea of Brutal Doom is that it takes Doom and makes it a fuckload better because it makes headshots count. You can use your chainsaw to, like, when you kill a Mancubus, you can use the chainsaw on the corpse to take the flamethrowers off of them. You can use the chainsaw on the Revenants and gain their rocket launchers and shit like that. When you get, you know, like, when you shoot, like, an imp or a zombie that doesn't quite kill them, but brings their health very low, they go into an animation where it looks like they're begging for mercy, and if you headshot them there, you get its health, you know? And fucking Brutal Doom is the best! And I love Brutal Doom. And now these guys come out and it's like, it is like, oh, by the way, we're adding these glory kills where if you do something brutal at the end of a kill, you get bonus health. Which sounds a lot like what I just described happens in Brutal Doom.
Yeah, well, that's fine. At least they're learning from, you know, what, because isn't Brutal Doom,
Brutal Doom is just a mod.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a mod that you just use for your other versions of the actual Doom game. You take the WAD files of whatever Doom game you feel like playing, like Doom 2.wad, and you drag it over top of the Brutal Doom file. And now you instead of it just like being able to strafe left and right and look left and right, you can look in every direction. You know, your guns are different. Your pistol is replaced with an assault rifle. Your double barrel shotgun can't do more than just shoot two shells at a time. You can, you know, control both sides of the barrel by right clicking or left clicking. So if you have the double shotty up and you see a zombie, you can just left click, shoot one barrel, and then reload quickly. Where if, like, you know, a pinky comes around the corner, you can use the double barrel to get the double power. You know? Yeah. You know, and weapons have changed the way that they look, the way that they function. The plasma rifle has to be reloaded. All weapons have to be reloaded. You know, not like it is in Doom, where, you know, you go through a shotgun and you'll go through all 100 fucking shells without ever having to reload. Well, Brutal Doom's like, a shotgun only holds so many fucking shells.
Mm-hmm.
So after 8 shots, you're forced to reload. So this new Doom is looking to, I don't want to say emulate, because Brutal Doom is a mod. So it's just something, you know, a guy created.
So basically what you're saying is that id went out there and said, you know what, hey, let's, you know, do something different that most other companies don't do, and look at what people liked about the game, what they've done over the years, and they probably noticed that a lot of people like the Brutal Doom mod, because a lot of times you see that shit, it's all, like, especially on YouTube, it's usually always Brutal Doom. And they were smart enough to say, okay, people like this for a reason, let's go in and see why they like it, and let's see what we can do to bring some of it into the game, to make those people happy, and to keep that fan base moving into the, you know, the new generation of Doom games. So, I don't know, maybe it was kind of smart they did that, because, I mean, as an example, Minecraft. They put out a lot of updates, and they add a lot of stuff, don't get me wrong. But the amount of mods out there already good and ready to use now, they could have added those in years ago. And they could have implemented so many of those things years ago, but they haven't. Because, right. You know, they want to be more original, they want to have their own kind of stuff or whatever, but it's like, okay, well, not to say that there's anything wrong with that, but kind of get over yourself. I mean, if your fan base is out there and saying, like, yeah, I really like that we can have backpacks and that I can have more than, you know, that I don't have to come back to my house every, you know, 5 minutes to offload crap, you know, why not put one into the game? Oh, well, I never thought of that, so, and somebody else did it, so I'm not going to do it. Right. Instead, id Software said, you know what, people like this, so let's try and put it into the new game.
Mm-hmm. And just to reference, like, the Brutal Doom Facebook page, this is just a Facebook page that this one guy made, okay? Brutal Doom is developed and created and worked on by a single person. This is one guy working on this.
Yep. Okay? A lot of mods are done by one person, and that's what's crazy. I mean, these people are just making mods. Why aren't they working for a video game company?
Right. And his Facebook page has 30,000 likes.
Yeah.
You know? So this is one guy making one mod and having that much likes, or that many likes, for a game, for a mod for an old game. So I have to eat a little bit of crow at this point and say, now that they've explained why there's so much melee in their trailers, it actually makes a hell of a lot more sense, and this new Doom is looking better than ever. So I apologize to id Software, I apologize to everybody who argued with me about it, I was wrong. This new Doom looks amazing. So, moving right along, Microsoft founder...
No, Minecraft.
Microsoft.
Minecraft, Bill Gates,
Minecraft,
like, no!
Founder Marcus Persson sold Minecraft to Microsoft...
Notch.
...for $2.5 billion about a year ago. And now he's basically using Twitch to tell the world how lonely he is.
Twitter.
Man alive, I'm terrible. Using Twitter. Oh, start this over with. Guy sold Minecraft. Now he's on Twitter telling everybody exactly how depressed he is. The problem with getting everything is run out of reasons to keep trying, and human interaction becomes impossible due to imbalance. When we sold the company, the biggest effort went into making sure the employees got taken care of, and they all hate me now.
Wait, what? Now that's, honestly, I got a feel for the guy, because it's true. I mean, if the guy looks out for his employees that much, yes, he sold the company for a lot of money, but he also ensured, I'm sure some of those people got a good chunk of money as well, you know, as a severance pay, and then on top of that big severance pay, they're getting hired back into Microsoft with Mojang, like, doing the same thing that they were always doing, so it's like, why would not. You... Yeah, but that's fine. Maybe he just needed a break. Maybe he just wanted a break. Whatever. Whatever his reasons are, there's no reason to hate him just because he didn't go with you. You know?
Yeah, I don't know. Hanging out in Ibiza with a bunch of friends and partying with famous people, able to do whatever I want, and I've never felt more isolated. No. I'm sorry. I just... The very first comment on this article is exactly how I feel about this. Dry your tears with all of your fucking money.
Woody Harrelson.
I mean, you sell a company for $2.5 billion, and then you're going to go into Twitter and complain about how bad your life is? You know what? There are millions and millions and millions of people who are isolated, who are, you know, who have social problems and whatnot, and have employers that don't like them. Buddy, get used to that. Your employers will not like you for one reason or another. You know, because you sold your company, it's just another reason, okay? But I'm sorry. You are a billionaire. Leave this stuff off of Twitter. I mean...
I don't know. I kind of understand where he's coming from just for the fact that...
I get it.
He's probably... You know, not one of those people who just frivolously spends money just because they have it. Yes, he bought a $70 million mansion. That's fine. He went out and he splurged. He moved out of Sweden. I'm pretty sure he's in Hollywood. But that's not to say that, you know, he's just going out and saying, well, I'm just going to buy a helicopter and a jet just because I have the money. He's probably more concerned with, okay, I have a nice place. I have enough money that I can retire and do stuff. But it's the same thing with anybody else. If your friends aren't around the same time that you're off and you have time alone, then you're sitting at home waiting for your friends to get off and have time to hang out with you. Mm-hmm. And I've had that situation a lot, mostly because of my work. I've been working, and for this entire month, I'm going to be working for, like, the entire time, more or less. So, you know, my amount of free time is very small. Like, I've been working nights this week, and it's, what, a Friday at 8? That I'm doing a podcast, and I have to get up the next morning and go right back to work again. So, yeah, I mean, I can understand that, you know, he's just, you know, waiting around for people to, you know, not be busy and to have someone there and, you know, to hang out with. But at the same time, I understand what you're saying. He has the money. It's like, hey, why don't you take, like, that, you know, $0.1 billion, throw it at someone and say, hey, look, retire with me and come hang out for a bit. We'll have all kinds of... Hey, Natch, if you need a buddy, let me know anytime.
Yeah,
no, I'm looking forward to retire right now. If you want to help me with that, I can help you have a good fucking time for the rest of your goddamn life.
Old World Gamer and I will make your life wonderful.
Indeed.
You just come and contact us. Let us know what you need.
I will screech you in as a fucking newfie.
Absolutely. But, like, c- come on, apply yourself to something. Yeah. You know, don't sit here on Twitter and just complain about how bad your life is. If you're that really that bored and you're really that isolated from everything, you've got the money to do whatever the fuck you want.
Make another Minecraft. You already done it once. Do something else. Make another one.
If you're really that bored, spend $1 million and make a restaurant or something like that. Manage a restaurant. Do something to be social. Don't sit and complain about it on Twitter. You know, you've got more money than 99.9% of the people in this world. Apply yourself with it. Don't sit and cry about it on Twitter, because you got guys like me who are just going to make fun of you for it. Because it's like, yes, I get the fact that you're isolated and you feel like you're farther away from people. Do something with yourself. Don't sit and watch my reflection in the monitor. You can do something with yourself, okay? So go do that. Go do something. So, ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, people of all ages, it is an Indie Pixels podcast, and it would not be complete if I didn't throw Bloodstained Ritual of the Night in there somehow. I promise you folks, there will be 1 week. There will be 1 week where I don't find Bloodstained news. I'm not sure how soon that's going to be. So, Bloodstained Ritual of the Night is going to feature customizations. In a picture that they gave us, or in an art highlight that they gave us, you'll be able to switch out different headgear, such as hats and hair and stuff like that. And depending on what you're wearing, the parameters of your character is going to change. So it's going to give them different boosts. So you may become stronger or faster or be able to jump higher. I have no idea.
So you're just Daft Punk.
Hey, whatever. Hey, if they were one of the guys that pledged towards the game, you know, give them the Daft Punk helmets. Whatever.
No. Faster.
Yeah.
Anyways.
It's also going to be, you're also going to be able to change the color of accessories and being able to change Miriam's hair color. But that was honestly one of the things that I liked about Symphony of the Night is when you got this cloak called the Joseph's Cloak, you were able to change the exterior and the interior color of the cloak. And I always loved making it mono white, because every time you did a double jump, it looked like it was a giant fucking angel, like, jumping into the air. It's like, oh, that's so fucking cool.
But is it like a Technicolor dream coat?
It's the Joseph's cloak, and you can change it to whatever color you want. So I guess that was the reference. That was the idea.
Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat. I'm just saying.
There you go. So, Jackbox Party Pack 2.
Say it again.
Was the Jackbox Party Pack 2.
That was fun.
Jackbox Party Pack 2 was announced at PAX Prime. And you're going to be able to get the Jackbox Party Pack 2, which is going to include one of my favorite Jack Party games of all time, Fibbage 2. It's new. The first one that I played, Fibbage, if you haven't played this game is hilarious, okay? The idea of Fibbage is that they give you a general fact about something in life. Like, in 2000, I'm just throwing out something random out there. This isn't something that's actually in the game. In 2005, Maria Wilson was the first person ever to do blank in space. And the idea of the game is that you're supposed to fill in the blank with ridiculous answers. And then everybody else will click on the answers that they either think is the real answer or a funny answer, you know? So if you think that Maria Wilson was the first one to fart in space, fart might be one of the answers. So you're like, she might have been the first to fart in space. I click on that one. And every time somebody chooses your answer, you get points. So it's basically an online party game of where you make up stuff that's supposed to be believable, you know? Mm-hmm. So is the idea is that if you pick the real answer, you get more points. Okay? And then you don't give points to the other players. Okay? So you want to try to create answers that you think are as believable as possible. So Fibbage 2 is the Call My Bluff-esque kind of multiplayer game, and it's going to be the Jackbox Party Pack 2. Jackbox Party Pack 2 is set to launch in autumn for PS4, Xbox One, PS3, and PC. And I'm relatively sure our last week's guest, Gene, my brother, we are probably going to end up streaming this game at some point. Because not only is the Jackbox Party Pack 2 going to contain Fibbage 2, it's also going to have You Don't Know Jack 2015. So, yeah. That.
Hmm.
A new You Don't Know Jack game. We're going to be right on that real quick. Don't you worry about that.
I can jack you off.
So, earlier this year, Nintendo decided that they were going to launch the new Nintendo 3DS XL in North America. People liked it, but they were confused as to why the smaller Nintendo 3DS wasn't available here, because I believe it was only in Japan that were only given like the new Nintendo 3DSs. Mm-hmm. So Nintendo's like, oh, you want the new Nintendo 3DS? We're going to give it to you. September 25th, we are going to get the new Nintendo 3DS. And not only that, it is going to be bundled with Animal Crossing Happy Home Designer.
Oh, so this is not an XL. This is a normal size one.
That is a normal size 3DS.
Oh.
Now, for me, I'm not a big fan of the big 3DS.
I like it.
There's something about it that just doesn't... I don't have very big hands. So, I know what you're thinking. Stop it.
Oh, no. I was looking at my own hands like, Jesus, I wish I could say that. That's why I fucking hated a lot of the handheld games, because they were too goddamn small. Game Boy? You know how fucking... That thing's not even wide. Just use one hand to play the thing. Thumb on one side and two fingers.
I could actually hold like one of those old, the original Game Boys. I could hold those comfortably. So I don't have big hands at all. So this new Nintendo 3DS is going to be packaged with Animal Crossing Happy Home Designer, and it's going to have a custom design on it.
And changeable faceplates.
Yes.
And it comes with one amiibo card and two different cover plates itself. So.
Yep, it'll be launching September 25th for about $220 American, which is about, you know... About right when it comes to getting a new console plus a brand new game. Yeah. Especially a game that has the name Animal Crossing on it. So
honestly, it looks nice. If it wasn't the small one, I'd probably go and get one, honestly. But I've been collecting the collector's editions of XLs recently, so...
Yeah. And this new Nintendo 3DS is also going to have... support for the amiibo figures, which is something that the smaller 3DSs before lacked.
That's true too, yeah.
You had to have the larger, the 3D XL to be able to support the amiibos on your 3DS. So that's going to be something new that you're going to be able to look forward to, is, you know, the amiibo tracking on your smaller 3DS.
Amiibo!
So, here I go, singing the praises of Nintendo. And I'm going to turn around and go right back where we started. Right back where Indie Pixels Podcast, before we had a name, one of our first subjects that we talked about is Nintendo and its ways of butting its heads into things that it kind of doesn't really belong. And Nintendo is starting to pull its crap once again on YouTubers. There is, I don't know if you can see this little picture here down there by ProJared, all of the copyright strikes that he's gotten.
From Mario Maker.
Yep. Nintendo, you're doing this again. you had like a 6 month period there where it was like, or it was more like a 4 month period, I'm sorry, where it's like, you know what, Nintendo's gonna stop being like that and we're gonna let you guys do your thing, and hey, we got this cool thing, this Mario Maker. You know, this is going to be really cool. You're going to be able to design your own levels. You know what the great thing about doing that sort of thing is? Showing it off! And now what is Nintendo going to do? Start copyright striking the things that you create on Mario Maker.
Now, there's something I will interject with on this.
Okay.
People have to realize that, you know how Nintendo finds this? Through the songs. All the music. Just turn it down! No one needs to hear the music! If you want to hear the music, go buy a fucking game! If that's what Nintendo's gonna do, then just turn the fucking audio off, do your commentary, put some fucking random fucking, OC Remix tunes in there, and you're fucking good to go. Nintendo can't do shit then. So, just... I understand why you're pissed off. You put all the work into it. But, I mean, it's not like, oh, well, no, I got copyright disputes on those videos. Yeah, but then you can go and redo them and still get the same amount of views, and everything's going to be fine. You just got to, you know, turn off the audio in the fucking game.
Yeah, I mean, it's just... Tom Fox, Twitter user, made the best comment on the matter. So, was that a recruitment strategy? We'd like to promote this game, a.k.a. Mario... or Mario Maker, and give us the money unless you join our program. See, I just... it's not... It's at this point, it's not worth the risk to play anything Mario on YouTube anymore. So why make something along the lines of, here's how you make Mario games, show it off. Oh, by the way, you don't make money off of this. So, if you want to make Nintendo videos on YouTube, you could always try the following things. One, lower the music and sound volume to zero, talk over the video, and add some free music from YouTube's library, or add a border to your video and shrink the size slightly. See, just so dumb. This is just so... Nintendo, why are you doing this again? I mean, I get the fact that, you know...
Oh, you know what happened?
Hmm.
Last week, remember how we were saying how awesome things were going with Nintendo with some of their more recent decisions?
Hmm.
That guy went on fucking holidays. Guaranteed he's on holidays this week.
Yep.
Just wait till he comes back and then make decisions and talk to him and be like, is this good or bad? And then when he says bad, then don't do it.
We did talk about this guy last week, didn't we?
What's that?
We did talk about this guy last week, did we not?
Who's that?
The guy who's going on vacation.
Oh, well...
That guy. That guy who makes all of the good executive decisions in Nintendo.
Pretty much.
I don't get it. I really don't get it. I mean, and they're going after big YouTube names, like Angry Joe and Pro Jared. I mean, what exactly are you trying to prove with these things? Oh, is big Nintendo swinging its dick around at some of, like, the most, you know, popular YouTubers? What the hell's the point in this? You know, are you trying to prove a point? Or are you really just trying to start a war with, you know, the wrong kind of people? Let's just use Jimmy Kimmel as a fucking example right now. Jimmy Kimmel, a week ago... you know, made comments about about YouTube gaming, and it has done nothing but create a backlash towards him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's a comedian, folks. Okay, this whole Jimmy Kimmel thing, honestly, in my opinion, have you seen anything about that at all?
No, actually, I seen it briefly, but I didn't really read over. I was like, I don't really care.
Yeah, but. It's created this giant backlash where he's gotten lots and lots of, like, hate mail and death threats and crap like that. And it's absolutely ridiculous. Guys, if you're listening to this and you hate on Jimmy Kimmel, stop being so fucking immature. The guy's a fucking comedian. He makes his living by making fun of things.
Right.
Don't get so fucking butthurt over it.
But see, it's the 2015, so that's the way things go. I'm telling you.
Everybody's butthurt over this. Oh, I posted a picture of my meal. Triggered. Oh, shut up. You're just stupid. So, guys, seriously, Jimmy Kimmel is a motherfucking comedian. Just get over the fact that he made fun of something you like. Okay? Yeah,
really, though.
Get over it. You know, get your head out of your ass. You are not that important to the world. Don't get me wrong. I think that YouTube gaming is a good idea. Do I think watching video games is fun? Absolutely. I wouldn't be where I am right now if I didn't think it was fun, if I didn't think it was important. Do I think Jimmy Kimmel's an asshole for what he said? No, because he was making fun of something, okay? But this is a completely different contrast. This is, you know, Nintendo going, oh, you're doing something, we don't like this, now we are going to take this away from you. You know, Jimmy Kimmel was just like, this is dumb. Nintendo's like, this is mine.
So, how dare you go out there and give us free advertising to thousands of people and make them go out there and be like, wow, I really like how Pro Jared played that game. I really want to buy Mario Maker. You making people buy my game? You goddamn son of a bitch. We're putting copyright strikes on you. How dare you sell games for us, you motherfucker. We want to pay for our marketing and advertising.
And a lot of these videos that they're copyright striking are reviews for the game.
Yeah.
And from what I've seen, most of everybody says it's a good game. Yep. It's a great game. It's fun as hell.
Of course it is.
So, Nintendo, what are you doing? These guys are doing nothing but singing your praises. And what do? You shoot them in the foot. Is there something wrong with you guys?
I told you. The dude is off on vacation. He has to be. There's no way that they made good decisions last week and then they turn around and do something stupid like this. Either that, or maybe that guy just doesn't like YouTubers or something. Maybe he didn't make it on YouTube and he ended up getting working at Nintendo. He's like, I'll have my revenge.
Yeah, apparently. I don't know. It's just...
It's a bit ridiculous. It's the same thing as, like, anything else. Like, with fucking Sega. Sega's all like, oh, better not play any Shining Force, because we're going to put a game out soon. It's like, you guys are a software company now making games, so how about just stop?
Folks, if you don't want them playing Shining Force games, don't make a new one. You know what you're going to do? You're going to take away something from these people. Like, Stefan, oh, I'm going to make a Shining Force game. I'm Canadian, blah, blah, blah. So,
I love Shining Force. It's awesome. You can get a bikini for one. And then, like, anyway. A lingerie for the other one. It's awesome.
So, old world gamer plays a lot of fucking games. Oh, I'm going to give Shining Force a 7,000 out of 10. This game's awesome. And then Sega's like, you're playing Shining Force. Go eat a dick.
I'm like, no, I'll pass, thanks. I'm just going to keep playing. Ba-da-din-din,
ba-da-din-din. So what have you successfully done here, Sega? Oh, we strike this game, you have to take it down. Well, Old World Gamer has 8,000 subscribers. Now there's 8,000 people who aren't going to see this Shining Force video, and now don't know what the game is, so that when you create a new game, if they haven't known what Shining Force was before, they're probably not going to be interested in it now.
Jesus Christ, Scott. I went and checked my channel. There's not 8,000 subscribers there, you fucking liar. I was like, I didn't even check today. I was like, I'm going to go have a look.
I'm never using you as an example again.
That's probably a good reason. Probably a good move.
In closing, Pro Jared says, dear YouTubers who want to do Super Mario Maker Let's Plays, you have been warned. So, yeah. Now, Capcom, I love you.
I love you a long time.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
And I cannot wait for Street Fighter V. I really want to play this game. They're doing something here which I don't understand. Okay. My favorite character to play in Street Fighter is Ryu. I've been a Ryu player since day one of playing a Street Fighter game. You know? Do I have a secondary character? Absolutely. My favorite character in all of Street Fighter, which is Cammy.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Cammy is some...
Now...
Whoa!
Have you looked at this picture, Stefan?
What happened?
That...
She got dreadlocks? What is that?
She's always had the braids.
No, braids is fun, but that top picture makes her look like she has, like, fucking dreadlocks or some shit. Oh,
it doesn't make her look like she has dreadlocks. It makes her look like she's, like, 12!
Is that Play-Doh hair?
I mean, am I wrong?
Maybe it's the angle she's at?
I mean, there's a second picture that you can click on down there. Like, but they show you, like, the one that's there, what Cammy looks like in Street Fighter 4, which was, by the way, fucking perfect. That is what I always look at Cammy. When I see Cammy in my head, that's what I see. The third picture there is how they've changed her in Street Fighter 5. And even that's awful.
I think they're trying to make her look... Asian. She almost... Oh, okay. I was going to say she looks more German.
She looks Asian, in my opinion. And I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, except that Cammy's not Asian.
Well, again, the angle of her face there is at a weird angle.
It looks bad.
Yeah.
So why is that a representation of what you're going to throw out there? This is what the new Cammy looks like. Ugh. Ugh.
Right, how are you going to give someone a Frankensteiner looking like that?
And then that fourth picture is like, oh my god, she's like 12. And I don't mean like the character from Street Fighter 3, Third Strike, folks. I'm not talking about that 12. I mean like 12 years old. You know? So, I feel like a dirty old man staring at them jubblies, you know
what I mean? Yeah.
You know? I'm gonna put this background on my computer because I like Cammy so much, and the FBI is gonna be like, you got child pornography on there. And I'm like, no, it's Cammy. And they're like, no, them not titties of a 20-year-old. You going to jail, bitch. So I just, you know what? There's two things that have always symbolized Cammy, okay? Her sex appeal, okay? It's just that. There's without question. Cammy is a sex appeal character.
Her first, like, finishing stances, or one of her first finishing stances was turning around and showing her ass, more or less, and then looking back at you and winking. I mean, yeah. Jesus Christ.
But, like, the most iconic thing about Cammy is her braids. Mm. Like, when you describe Cammy, the first thing that comes to mind are those fucking braids.
The braid and the beret.
Right. And this new costume, I don't understand. They take the braids away completely. And no bueno, Capcom. Uh-uh.
Maybe that's why she's got those skiing goggles there. Maybe she just likes to have the wind blowing through her hair instead of having a big old braid.
Sure. I mean, the pre-order Ryu costume where he's got that big gruffy beard... I can get into that. You know, Ryu is a tireless wanderer. He wanders the roads, and you know, maybe he goes a month without ever seeing a razor. I can see that. You know, I can understand that. Ryu getting this big old gruffy thing? Yes. Understandable, you know. But then it would be like trying to, you know, I'm trying to think.
I like her utility belt. That utility belt looks pretty badass, though. She's ready to fucking go.
I guess, but it's like...
She's like a mom with snacks to go there. Look at her.
She almost reminds me of like a thief or something like that, which...
Well, I guess they call it a stealth makeover, so maybe that's why?
I don't know. But it's just... She looks too young in that picture.
Boobies!
Again, like you said, yeah, that. I mean, it's just like, her face looks like she's 12, her chest looks like she's ready to go. I mean, it's just, good lord.
Sometimes that happens.
Well, I get that, but...
I know what you're saying. So...
I'm making a point, goddammit! Stop it! So, Yeah, this whole new Cammy look, I just, you know, I don't agree with it at all, Capcom. And, you know, my voice is very small, and our podcast doesn't get to a lot of people. But, Capcom, if you just happen to hear this, if you want to use that kind of costume, braid the hair again, and I don't even care anymore. It's just, it Cammy without the braids just isn't Cammy. You know?
He likes to have a handle.
I guess.
Anyways.
A little short here. Nothing that I have really too much to report on. But you're going to be getting a Fallout Monopoly.
I'm not surprised. They've pretty much done Monopoly everything.
So, apparently it's coming soon. Fallout Collector's Edition for Monopoly. So, New Vegas as a boardwalk? Maybe?
Sure.
Though I'm not really sure how they're going to be able to get 15,810 bottle caps inside the box.
There'll be paper bottle caps, I'm sure.
But, yeah. Fallout Monopoly. Not really sure when, but I'm just going to guess it's probably going to be sometime around when Fallout 4 releases, which is November 10th. So, it's probably going to be roughly around there. So, there's that. Also, another small thing that I want to also let you guys know. Ace Attorney 6 has been announced. Now,
not a fan of the Ace Attorney games.
Stefan! Oh, you broke my heart!
Why?
I love the Ace Attorney games. They're so unique. They're so much different. I mean, I understand. Not everybody likes the same kind of games, you know. I'm just messing with you. But for me, the Ace Attorney games have just been like, they're so much fun. They're so challenging. And they require you to do just so much thinking and backtracking. And you actually want to take notes while you're playing this game. It makes you feel like a real attorney. When you don't take notes or you don't, you know, pay attention to little details, you miss things and you lose your court case.
Oh, you mean play a game? You mean like just play? Like.
Yes.
No, well, I'm just saying that there's so many people out there who play video games, they don't even bother to fucking read anything, so it's like, why the hell does anyone ever play Ace Attorney if they have to read stuff?
Right?
Fuck.
But, Famitsu said that Ace Attorney 6 is in the making. They do not have a release date as of yet. But they're going to be showing it off at Tokyo Game Show 2015, which is going to be September 20th to the 20th. I'm sorry, the 17th to the 20th. So, you folks said you wanted a Star Wars Battlefront beta. So, yeah, you guys are going to be getting one.
There you go.
Coming early October to PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and on Origin for PC, the Star Wars Battlefront beta is going to be a technical test and will feature Walker Assault on Hoth, a 40-man multiplayer battle featuring Rebels and the Empire. And you are also going to be able to play as Darth Vader or Luke Skywalker.
That's kind of cool.
The beta will also feature a survival mission on Tatooine, where you and a rebel friend must fight back waves of Imperial forces. So, kind of going to sound like Horde on Gears of War. So, I'm not sure when this is going to happen.
Early October?
Is that what it says?
Yeah, coming early October to all of them.
Yeah, so there you go. You're going to be getting a Battlefront beta. So
Walker Assault on Hoth. Woo!
Mm-hmm.
And survival mission on Tatooine.
So, moving along,
Dark Side of Gaming has given us an article about the Steam report of almost 60 million copies of games were sold on Steam in the month of August.
Jesus.
Damn. That's a lot. So, the 10 best-selling games of Steam in August were, in order, number one, Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, I can see that.
Yeah, makes sense.
Number two, Rocket League. Number three, Garry's Mod. Number four, and I'm really surprised to still see this being sold, Left 4 Dead 2.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Number five, Race the Sun. Number six, Sid Meier's Civilization 5. Number seven, H1Z1. Number eight, Borderlands 2. Number nine, again, another one that I'm really surprised to see that's a top seller, Skyrim.
Skyrim!
And number 10, Arma 2, Operation Arrowhead. The top 10 best-selling games that were released in August. Number one, Planetary Annihilation Titans. Number two, Final Fantasy Type-0 HD. Three, Shadowrun Hong Kong. Four, Hacknet. Five, Fairy Fencer F. Six, Fingered.
Ew.
I almost don't want to know what that's about.
We already talked about it.
Did we?
Yeah, remember? It's the guy with, what is it? Lazy... No, something to do with his penis. We were looking at the mugshot there for one guy. What was it? Oh, I can't remember what it's called now. But yeah, I showed you the article.
Oh, yeah! That's the... Right! This is... Yeah, it's the one where it's like, subtle penis.
Subtle penis. It's like, wait, what? Is it out all the time? You just don't realize it?
Subtle penis.
It's like, I have a subtle penis.
Okay, I actually remember that now. Okay, I'm sorry. Number six, Fingered. Number seven, Zombie. Number eight, Sheltered. Nine, Nico Para, Volume Zero. And 10, Big Pharma. So, I'm honestly really surprised to see some of these games here. Like, Left 4 Dead 2 as the number four seller in August? Over 300,000 copies of Left 4 Dead 2?
Yep.
Wow.
People should have got the free copy that they gave out Christmas 2 years ago.
Right? And Skyrim? 152,000 copies of Skyrim?
Everyone likes a rim job.
I mean, you also see how many copies that they've sold of this game now?
What?
9.4 million. Copies of Skyrim on Steam alone.
They've sold 1.1 of Rocket League so far. It's only been out for a little while.
And Counter-Strike Global Offensive tops that list of those sellers, almost 16 million.
Jesus.
Damn.
That's because I'm pretty sure you need Counter-Strike in order to use like parts of Garry's Mod too.
Sure, I haven't even touched Garry's Mod, so I don't even know what it's about. I know what the game's about. Yeah. I don't know what you need to do to make it run.
Well, what was it that we were playing? The hide and seek version, Prop Hunt, and oh my god, that shit! I could play that for fucking hours. That was so much fun, just like turning into what is it? A projector remote, and then just running away from people, and then hiding under a car. Oh god, fucking hilarious!
So, Deus-Ex Mankind Divided.
What?
Has what is being called the worst pre-order bonus structure of all time.
Ever.
Okay. Now, what they're calling augmenting your pre-order is a tiered system that actually forces customers to make a choice about what kind of stuff that's going to be bundled with your game at launch. So not only are you paying extra to move up the ranks of a ladder, but at each rung, you have to leave stuff behind. Tier 1 makes you choose between 3 skin packs and arms loadout for the game itself. Tier 2 makes you choose between a digital art book or soundtrack sampler.
Oh.
Tier 3 finally lets your mind rest and gives you just an extra in-game mission. Tier 4 makes you choose once more, this time between a digital comic book and a novella. Tier 5 is a flat-out early release of the game 4 days before the official relaunch. Or before the official launch.
Jesus.
Apparently, that's how this works, is that the tiers are unlocked the more people pre-order, so you're supposed to encourage your friends to do so in order for all of you to maximize your potential for loot. If you want all of it, and you don't want it to make any decisions, you have to shell out $150 for the collector's editions of the game, which comes with everything. So you're receiving everything listed above for $90, 150% more than the price of the game itself. I don't understand. Or I'm sorry, you get all of that collector's stuff for an extra $90. So the whole thing is $150. If I don't know if I said that or not, but.
But I mean, you also get a figurine and an art book and a limited edition steel book. With the collector's edition, so at least you get something else besides just that shit.
But all the crap at the bottom, I mean, an extra in-game mission, skins and weapon skins, music, digital books.
Yeah.
Is
the best.
What? What?
What? Yeah, this is, I don't know, it's kind of weird.
What?
No, I wasn't serious. Calm down.
What? Dios, are you serious? Is this an actual thing you're doing? I mean, an art book, skins, an extra mission, and a couple comics, plus a Jensen figurine? And you're gonna charge people $150? You're gonna charge people $90 for all that stuff? Dios, have you lost what's left of your fucking mind? I can't even try to justify this. Stefan, help me.
Nope.
I'm moving on.
Mm-hmm.
So, back away from crap and into a new new good game. Well, not a new good game, but a good game, period. Destiny the Taken King Raid has finally been given a release date, which is September 18th, 2015.
Yes!
Only 3 days after Destiny the Taken King is going to be released, so you're going to be given 3 days to wait for the raid. So, whatever. So, get yourself hyped, get yourself ready for this upcoming raid, because it's coming in only, by the time it's 2 weeks. So, Destiny the Taken King, 2 weeks.
Three days, no!
Right? And that's a little bit of information I'd like to give you guys. The PS4 and the 3DS versions of Shovel Knight, when ordered on Amazon, are going to be getting discounts.
Boo.
You're going to be getting a 20% discount on the PS4 and the 3DS versions of Shovel Knight. So not only is you're going to be getting Shovel Knight for 20% off, remember, the physical copies of the PS4, the 3DS, the PlayStation Vita, and I want to say the Xbox One version of Shovel Knight are all going to come with the DLC, and the name of it escapes me at the moment.
I know what you're talking about, Plague Knight.
Yeah. But all these physical versions of Shovel Knight will be released on October 13th in North America. So you guys have just another month to wait for
2016.
There's a whole bunch of other things that Amazon has going to be giving deals and pre-orders for. gonna try to, you know, just find there's a couple.
There's a lot of different things there to.
Yeah, a 500 gigabyte PS4 console with Destiny the Taken King limited edition bundle. Final Fantasy X and X-2 HD remasters are gonna for PS4 30% off. A lot of Halo 5 Guardians things you're gonna be able to look through. Just Cause 3, Phantom, a whole bunch of Phantom Pain stuff. And let me tell you folks, guys, let me tell you guys this. Looking for news this week, it was like needle in a haystack. And you know what the haystack was? Everything Phantom Pain.
Yeah, I know.
There was a lot of Phantom Pain stuff, and I just...
I at least found a lot about some newer indie games and stuff that are coming out, so...
Yeah.
At least we got some more of that, them things as well, so...
there's a lot of stuff that Amazon has for deals and pre-orders right now. So go check that stuff out.
Indeed.
So Stefan, I will now pass the torch of news onto you.
Ah, burnt my fingers. God damn it! Why do you always pass it flame first? What the fuck?
I got a hold of somehow.
Okay, so starting off with a good one.
Oh yes. Oh, God, yeah.
There's a new game coming out called Cibele. Apparently, it's a game where you discover your sexuality on the internet. You play as a teenager. Whoa. As soon as I seen that, I was like, are you serious? You guys are really making a game about this? Like, I can just imagine where this could go, because, I mean, what are they taking into account? I mean... You know, think of all the things that we had as growing up. First, you had the chat rooms, and then you had like MSN, like what is it, MSN Messenger and stuff. Like, whatever happened to that? Oh, Skype. There you go. Which it pretty much did replace MSN Messenger. But anyways, yeah. And I mean, I'm sure the kids got all these fucking apps and shit now on their phones. I mean, it's not like, you know, it's anything new. I think that this is someone probably just finally figured out, like, hey, this has been going on for a while. Why don't we just make a game about it? Plain and simple.
It's like in the description, it's like this is like an autobiography of somebody who's done something like this.
It's having a strong affection, like she walked towards him, katana brandished, lips parted. And other absolute nonsense that makes me cringe to think about. Whoa. But yeah, I don't know how this is going to go, but I'm sure it's going to be very interesting, at the very least.
Sure, but yeah, I don't think I'll be participating in this one. There's a lot of games that when we find, it's like, oh, this looks cool. I'm pretty sure that this is a beautiful title tale about what happens when you discover your sexuality on the internet.
Yeah.
You know what they call that? Jail time.
Yeah, pretty much.
So yeah.
I don't know. I just thought it was very interesting that someone actually went through the trouble of doing this, and that, like I said, they put two and two together and say, hey, it's already out there, let's just make a game about it. Because I'm sure there's probably a lot of people out there that don't realize how much of that shit's going on out there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, tons.
Yeah.
But, am I going to sit there? Am I going to play a game that involves me being a teenage girl flirting with a guy on an MMO?
Oh, wait, an MMO?
Yeah.
Is that what this is going to be? I didn't think this was an MMO, though.
That's what the game's about. That is what the game's about.
Oh, okay. That's kind of different. No, if it's an online MMO thing, I would not play it, because that's just... No, that is exactly what you said. You said it's not enough, right. It's not jail time.
It's about a girl who finds a guy online.
Oh, okay. Game,
and... they start flirting, and then they want to try to meet each other, and blah, blah, blah. It's like, oh my god, what am I fucking playing?
But see, that's what I'm saying. That's why I would play it, just because it's so fucked up. But I'm glad that you cleared that up, because if that was an actual MMO, there would be no way I'd be touching that thing. Like, nope, it's not, no.
I'm going to play this one, beat it, and then load up my copy of Replay and get onto that one, too.
I'm just gonna add this to the block list.
Good lord. Yeah, okay. I'm done with that.
Indeed. So, more new games. Tenertia, which is now available on Steam and came with a launch discount available. Apparently, it's going to be a top contender this year for Platformer of the Year.
This looks so fucking neat.
Oh, yeah. The game is... It looks excellent. I mean... This is why I love indie games as much as I do, because they can look like anything and just... Oh, look at this.
It looks so neat.
It does, yeah. Now, this kind of reminds me a little bit of what I think they're going to try and do a little bit with Chibi Robo. But yeah. This looks a little bit more interesting. Like, this is how Chibi Robo should have been done.
And the idea of the game is that you're supposed to go from point A to point B, propelling yourself with only rocket jumps.
That's pretty awesome.
Yep. Indeed. Okay. I have played enough TF2 to be right on that fucking train. Yeah, I gotta get my soldier practice in now because, Tenertia is going to basically be how good are you at rocket jumps?
Yeah. So, if you go and watch the trailer and you are interested, it is available right now on Steam. Go get it.
Mm-hmm.
You know you want to. A very interesting piece of news popped up under my screen saying that there is a Mega Man movie being made. Now, the only thing that they have said so far is that they don't know if it's going to be animated or if it's going to be live action.
No, don't make it live action.
A lot of people are swaying towards live action because of the guy who's looking after it. So, I mean, it's being developed by, 20th Century Fox and Chernin Entertainment, with Peter Chernin, who done, Planet of the Apes, Oblivion, The Heat, and Exodus Gods and Kings. So...
Sure, that's okay.
Yeah.
Peter Chernin.
But, I mean...
That's fine.
But what I'm worried about is, like you said, it's live action. Usually when they do video game movies and it's live action... It's live shit. It's like literally watching turds jump around on a screen.
Like, there's a reason I want to say this. Stefan, name me a good live-action video game movie.
That's what I'm saying. Double Dragon, only because you get to see her ass when she's going into this. Sorry, I had to.
The answer is no.
No.
The answer is no.
I don't want to.
It's not that you don't want to, Stefan. It's that you can't. You can't name one. Because there isn't a good one.
Yeah.
There are zero.
Sure it's not, yeah.
As much as I, as an individual person, liked Doom, and I know I'm the only one on the planet who says this. I liked Doom.
The movie? Sorry.
Yes. I liked it.
Whoa.
I know, folks. My arms are out. You can nail me to the cross now, okay? So, I'm sorry. I liked the Doom movie. And I disliked the Resident Evil movies.
Honestly, I'll watch pretty much anything, even if it is shitty, so...
Well, of course. But, I honestly think that this needs to be animated. This has to be animated. And you know what really it needs? It needs, like, the same voice actors. It needs the same voice actors that they had from the animated Mega Man. Mm-hmm. Like, the Dr. Wily. He was a perfect Dr. Wily, in my opinion. The guy who played Mega Man, I thought, was a really good voice actor for Mega Man. the scripts that they were given.
Wasn't it Goku? Horrific. The guy done Goku for the American?
Was it Sean Schumel? Was it?
Really? I thought so. Maybe I'm wrong, but anyways. Oh, he's looking it up now. He's got to.
I have to. Mega Man TV series. I actually have to look this up. No. Sean Schumel was not in there anywhere. Voiced by Ian James Corlett.
What else has he done?
Oh my god, he's done. Oh my god!
Yeah, I know his voice, so.
Dragon Ball Z, Goku and Master Roshi.
See, I told you!
He was the.
You were like, oh, was this guy? I'm like,
eh. How was Dragon Ball Z, Goku? I thought Sean Schumel was the voice actor for Goku. Or was it like that original translation where. There were two voice actors for Goku.
How dare you?
Hmm.
Yeah, he's done a lot of stuff.
This guy has done a lot.
Yeah, and good stuff too. Acting. And good stuff too, isn't it? It's like mostly good stuff, I'm pretty sure.
I mean, he was in Captain N, the Game Master.
Oh, he was probably fucking Captain N.
No, it was Dr. Wily, Pero, Alucard, and Dr. Wright.
Wow.
He was the announcer of Cartoon Network for a while.
Jesus. Dude knows how to get fucking paid.
Holy shit.
See, I'm telling you, man.
He is Silver Shill in My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. That's a thing.
Friendship is magic.
Yep. I'm trying to go through the rest of this. Shut up.
It's way too much fun.
In Final Fight, he was Dan D.
Oh, cool.
He was Blinky in Pac-Man and the Ghostly Adventures. Remember that?
I don't.
You don't remember that?
I don't think so. I'm not sure. I don't think so.
Oh, damn. That was like one of the original Pac-Man cartoons.
So anyways, we should probably move on to more news.
Probably, yeah.
So, and next thing I have here is a piece of equipment. And it's actually very unique and awesome sounding. It's the Asus GX700. It's a 4K laptop, 17-inch display, and it's water-cooled.
This is the strangest-looking laptop, while being the most awesome-looking laptop I have ever seen.
I want one of those. It really does look good. I like it. And apparently it has a K-Series Skylake processor and an unannounced NVIDIA GeForce graphics card.
Right.
So, I mean, this thing is packing, so there's probably a reason why it's water-cooled. But a 4K display? That sounds fucking... Oh!
Yeah.
That's worth it.
Yeah. Water-cooled laptop.
Yeah.
That has to say something.
Mm-hmm. It's gonna be expensive. I mean, just having a 4K display alone is going to be expensive. But then adding on the functionality of being able to put nice, cool water into your water cooling system so that you can keep your laptop nice and cold and running nice while you're gaming or rendering up fucking videos. And you're like, oh god, please do not go through my desk like thermite. Please, don't. It's true. Laptop equals thermite once it's rendering videos.
Mm-hmm. It's only true.
So, yeah. I don't really have any other information about this.
I don't think anybody does.
It's just some more or less some information that they have on the system itself. So, So yeah, if you're interested in that, go and check that out, because believe me, it looks fucking insane. That's a wide-ass display.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that's a wide 17 inches. Jesus. Okay, so we have a trailer to watch. This is just an environment trailer for a sci-fi horror game called Soma. So I am ready to play whenever you are.
Yep.
And go. Ooh, it said nudity.
Alright.
When I was little, I used to climb the stairs all the way to the top of the building.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I stepped out onto the roof and watched the smog rise and fall over Taipei. Street food vendors filled the air with aromas of all my favorite foods. The streets below were shadowed by the tall buildings. The people pushing through the crowd flowed like paint from an artist's brush. I felt the warm wind in my hair. For a brief moment, I felt connected to the world in a way that I never had before. It was the most profound feeling of comfort and sense of belonging I could ever hope for.
Okay.
So basically, while she was saying that stuff, what you were missing there was, like I said before we started, is that it was a trailer just showcasing underwater environments in the game. And it definitely has a nice creepy feel to it. And again, with games, the newer games coming out, they do keep seeming better and better. And the horror games have come a long way from where they were, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm a big fan of all of this. All of the horror games. They're my favorite. They're not my favorite.
It's okay, Scott. I understand.
But it's because they're getting better and better and better at their craft. I think that's the reason why.
Yeah.
I've never really been a big fan of the horror genre, period.
Me too.
I never really watched, you know, the Freddy or Nightmare on Elm Street. You
know, no, I've watched them, but I mean, usually it's because, like, I was hanging out with my uncle, and he decided that he wanted to watch them, so I was like, oh, okay, I guess I'll watch them. That's why I watched them.
Yeah, and for me, it's like, you know, I grew up with a family that really wasn't into that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever a friend was like, oh, let's watch this movie, and, you know, it's like a horror movie, I didn't do very well with it because, you know, I really wasn't, you know, into that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So because I've had very little, you know, in depth to the, you know, the horror genre, you know, I'll be the first guy to admit I've never seen a Nightmare on Elm Street movie. I've never seen a Halloween movie. You know, all of that stuff. I've never seen any of them.
I don't think I've seen any of the Halloween movies myself. I think I've seen part of the first one, but then either fell asleep or left or something.
You know, and the only horror movies that I've ever watched in the last 15 years are all comedy horror movies.
Oh, yeah, you know? Yeah.
You know, like Scream or whatever the hell it was called, or whatever it was with the Damon Wayans or whatever the fuck that movie was called. But you know, that's the point that I'm getting, is that I didn't do very well with horror movies. So, you know, even now as an adult, where I realize that these are all just movies, but, you know, the horror genre to me is just like, it's not very attractive. Mm-hmm. So, I think people get the most entertainment on my channel when I do Let's Plays is when I play those horror games.
Yeah.
Because yeah. I don't do well with them. Do I play them anyway? Yes, because you people fucking hate me sometimes, I think. You know? Because you guys get the most entertainment out of listening to me scream like a little girl. You know? When I did fucking Five Nights at Freddy's, I did 3 episodes of that. I got to day 3 and quit the game because I couldn't play it anymore. My problem with that? Maybe it was because I was playing the game at 4 o'clock in the morning. Maybe that was my problem.
Yeah, that's, you shouldn't
but
do that.
But still, I do that on purpose. I play the games this late at night to get into that element, you know? Because I know I'm bad at these things. So what do? Put myself in an environment where I know it's going to be worse. So you guys can get a genuine reaction from me. I'm going to start a horror series relatively soon, and it might be like me playing with somebody else horror series. Whoa. I'm not sure on that yet. So I may be doing one by myself. I may be doing it with a friend. So I'm not sure yet. But
cool.
That's something that's coming. So these sort of games, they look like they're really fun. So do I want to play them? Yes.
Sometimes, will I? Yes.
Probably not.
I understand. But
I will say, though, that the trailer did look very good.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think I was talking to you about this, I think it was before we started podcasting, but the Until Dawn game that I'm sure a lot of you have heard about by now and probably seen lots of Let's Plays of, it is a horror game, but at the same time, the whole game plays like a really good story. Me and Robin sat down and watched, and I know some people are going to be like, oh my god, wait a minute! Me and Robin sat down and watched PewDiePie play it.
Mm.
And if you want to see PewDiePie being a Let's Player and actually be enjoyable because you're afraid that he's yelling and, you know, overdoing it kind of thing, then this is the one to watch, because he's not like that. He's playing it as a general, just, you know, as, you know, just normally. And I guess if that's what you've always wanted to see from him, well, now you can see it, I guess. But I'm sure he's done it with plenty of other games as well, but I mean, when stuff scares him, it scares you too, because you're not expecting it at all.
Right.
But, I mean, that's the whole point of horror games to begin with, so.
Yeah.
But, anyways, next thing I have here is a new game that's coming out that first, this new investor-oriented, I guess, initiative called Fig. Just had its first project funded through a new investor, you know, having more or less people crowdfunding it. And it's called Outer Wilds. And Outer Wilds decided that we're going to put out a playable alpha for the people who crowdfunded us. So it's pretty cool. I thought that was pretty nice of them to, you know, go out of the way for that. But it says that they're the first project to be funded, so I guess I don't know because further down in the article it says there's 15 days left in its campaign. Outer Wilds has attracted $101,000 of its $125,000 goal.
Right.
So, assuming that they actually make it, then I guess they will go through with it. But I mean, I guess that's why they're putting out a playable alpha.
Possibly. I mean, I'm not sure what to make of its of just this picture. So
it's supposed to be a space exploration game. So I'm not sure. Like, is it going to be? Jeez, I always derp on the name of that game that I was watching someone play, where you grow the big vines out of the thing that's growing in the planet or whatever, and you have to make it back up to your spaceship as this little robot dude. And you pick up leaves and you can float with them. Anyways, it looks a lot along the lines of that, but it's more first person as opposed to third person.
Right.
But I don't know. It was just interesting that there's a new quote-unquote Kickstarter type group called Fig. And I guess, you know, for having a project reach $101,000, you know, out of a $125,000 goal, that's pretty big, no matter what website it's on. So, yeah, I just figured it was worth mentioning.
They have 13 days right now. They're still roughly $14,000 short of their goal. So, I'm pretty sure that they'll probably make that mark.
More than likely, yeah. Seems like it.
But, yeah, you got an alpha to try, folks.
So, if you haven't seen it yet, Humble Bundle has a Tom Clancy bundle. It's worth $180, and you only have to pay a minimum of $8.35. Or actually, sorry. Whoa, they added a lot of extra stuff here that I haven't seen. And there's still more games to come, apparently. So, let's go through this. The first tier here, so anything below $8.35, you'll get Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six, Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six 3 Gold, Raven Shield, and Athena Sword. You'll also get Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Vegas, Tom Clancy's Splinter Cell Chaos Theory, Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon, Rainbow Six Siege Multiplayer Beta, and at the $8.35 tier, you'll get Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Vegas 2, Splinter Cell Conviction Deluxe Edition, the original Splinter Cell, and this More Games Coming Soon part. So, meaning when next Tuesday release more games, you get them all. You also, at the $10 tier, you can get Splinter Cell Blacklist and Ghost Recon Future Soldier. And then there's a huge tier, a $75 or more tier, where you get Rainbow Six Siege pre-order. You also get an exclusive Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege t-shirt. And you also get 66% off of any three Ubisoft titles in the Humble Store as a coupon, which excludes pre-orders. So, I mean, if you're going to go ahead and get the Rainbow Six Siege game pre-ordered anyways, I mean, you might as well throw in a t-shirt and, 66% off of three games from the Humble Store as well. That's pretty good as well, so.
Pretty good.
It's going to be interesting to see what else they're going to throw in there. Jesus.
Right, I know. They already got a lot of stuff on there, and they're not even done yet.
No. And that's the nice thing about Humble Bundle. But honestly, myself, I'm not a big Tom Clancy gaming person. So I've been kind of holding out for another good Humble Bundle. I'm hoping for another good one soon. So, if you've ever played tactical RPGs or any board games, or if you're into 1980s cartoons with anthropomorphic heroes, then you are going to enjoy Armello. Armello launched September 1st on Steam. And basically, it's a board game tactical RPG with these anthropomorphic heroes. And apparently, there was already early access for the game, and, I'm just looking at through. There's 8 playable characters. Multiplayer matchmaking has been revamped.
Yeah, this reminds me, this very much reminds me a lot of the Witcher board game. And that board game, I mean, this reminds me a lot of it. And that Witcher board game was hella fun.
Yeah.
So, I mean, maybe I'm, not seeing it right, I mean, there's a lot of similarities, look like, so far, but, this looks pretty neat. I'm all about board games, y'all know that.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I mean, that's one of the reasons why I brought it up.
Yeah, I mean, so, and anthropomorphic animals, it's always a plus, because, anthropomorphic animals are cool.
Now, can I also make a quick mention of something that's completely off topic? I just noticed that the share icon on the top part of this video here, it strangely looks a lot like the Steam logo. I'm surprised that they haven't had their... I'm surprised they haven't had some words with each other for that.
They do look very similar.
I just noticed, I was like, wait, Steam? I was like, why is that up there? And it was like, share. Oh! What?
Yeah, you just turn that thing sideways a little bit and you got yourself a Steam logo there. That's pretty close. Mm. Yeah, you're right.
So anyways, if you're interested in Armello, it's currently on Steam for $19.99.
And the game looks pretty damn fun. So
if you're interested in board games,
at least go and check the trailer. I think it'll be worth it.
So, how much do you like shmups?
Have you been around my channel?
Mm-hmm.
I gotta actually record some new Holy Hell coming relatively soon. I like them.
Well, coming to Steam this winter, cave shmups. Yeah, you stop talking, you stupid commercial. And basically, these are bullet hells. Apparently, this is probably going to be one of the more, what would you call it? I guess hardcore shoot 'em up type games and stuff.
It looks like it.
Yeah. So, if you're into that sort of thing, into the bullet hell kind of thing, then you have lots to look forward to very soon. So, and if you wanted to see more about these cave shmups, go to caveshmups.com. That's where you'll find most of them. So.
I mean, I like these sort of games, so I would very much promote this sort of stuff. I mean, I'm horrible at them, so I'm not very good, but I like them.
Indeed, and me too.
They're a lot of fun. Me too.
Me too.
God, we haven't been able to insert that into anything in quite some time. I'm quite happy with myself, but yeah, caveshumps.com. CaveShumps.com. They got some stuff coming, so if you like bullet hells, it looks like they're going to be doing at least one game, so
yeah.
Go take a look.
So we mentioned it before, and I'm going to mention it again. World of Warcraft. Warcraft the movie is coming out soon. Apparently, there has been some film footage that has emerged online.
I'm gonna have to take a look.
Because we were looking at images before. Now we have footage. So, I'm looking at it. Whoa. This looks like a trailer. Oh, it is a trailer! It's a Russian trailer! Or something like that. And then the people who aren't Russian would be like, no, that's us. God damn it.
See, now I want to know who all these guys are.
Right? Who's that? Oh, shit. That was a big-ass orc. Holy shit.
Barkapot!
Indeed.
Whatever that means in Russian.
June 2016. Shit. Yep.
We got another year to wait for it, but still, looks. It's Warcraft. I'm gonna go see it. Indeed. That's all I gotta say.
So, if you've ever played SimCity, then you probably like this new game called Prison Architect. It's in its final alpha right now, final alpha 36, and it's out right now. What are you giggling at?
This is so stupid.
What is game?
Oh my god.
They had Roller Coaster Tycoon. Do you know how many people bought and played Roller Coaster Tycoon?
Absolutely. But roller coasters are fun. Roller coasters are, hey, I'm going to go with my family out to this amusement park. Look at that thing up there. That looks like a lot of fun. I'm going to put my family on this. We have a lot of fun. Oh, this is cool. I'd be happy playing a video game about making these things. I'm going to make the best roller coaster ever. Here's like, yeah. You have murderers, rapists, and other not law-abiding citizens in a SimCity game.
Well, all you gotta do is put them all, like, I'm sorry to have to say this, but you segregate them. Put all the rapists together, and then put all the, like, the murderers together. So then the murderers kill each other, the rapists will just rape each other. I mean, it'll all work out. I mean, if you rape a rapist, is it really rape? I don't even... That's a really different question to ask, but it has to be asked. So there you go.
I'm sorry. They're just... I mean, let's make a SimCity game about putting people in prison. Yay!
But see, there's that many things with prison in it now that people are okay with. Like, Orange is the New Black, and then there was Oz, and then there's this other one. I think it starts with like a W or some Wentworth or something like that. Like, and then you have all the gangster movies, and then you have like, what is it, Sons of Anarchy. There's always stuff to do with the criminals and stuff. So that's I don't think that's that big a deal.
So the first comments down there, I'm still hoping that when the game launches, there'll be a proper story campaign. That's always been one of the strongest draws for me. I want scenarios invented where you need to do certain things, a la theme hospital. And the response was, you make your own story. Mine was of a lonely businessman who forces maximum security prisoners with low sec. After 200 stabbings, he was thrown to jail with them. I played for 3 hours running away, unable to do anything.
Jesus.
Oh my god. This just... I don't know. I mean, SimCity is about making a city where people live and you make...
Same thing! It's just you're making a prison city where people are held.
You have a commerce and you have people working.
Exactly, you have people working the cookers, you have them make license plates, you have them sew uniforms, do laundry. And then you were talking about, then you have like, oh, well, you make parks and stuff in SimCity. Well, then you make outdoor areas for people to go and, like,
play lift basketball, weights run and the track and shank each other's in the corner.
Whatever you're into.
I'm moving on.
What do you mean?
I'm not clicking on that anymore.
What do you mean anymore? How many times did you click on it?
Just one.
Was that enough?
That was more than enough. Oh my god.
Anyways, another movie that's going to be apparently that's already in the works by Lionsgate is Borderlands. I was very surprised when I seen that pop up. I was pretty surprised at Mega Man, but then I seen Borderlands. I was like, wait, what? Why are they making so many movies?
Sure. I mean, I'm not sure what they're going to make it about.
Mm.
I mean, Tales of the Borderlands kind of took away the opportunity to do anything with Handsome Jack, so...
Mm.
Sure? I mean, if they've got something they can do, what about? Sure.
They could do a Tales from the Borderlands thing.
Sure. I mean, as long as they get, like, a real fucking Maya in there.
Hmm.
But put her up in that Maya costume, I'd be able to buy that. You know. I love tell them to get that Maya in there.
I love me some sirens in there. I'll tell you what.
Whoa. Yep. I personally would go see it. I know Gene would see it. I mean, he's, like, only obsessed with Borderlands. So, there's that. But, yeah. Borderlands movie, acceptable. Mega Man movie, acceptable.
So, the last thing I have here is a new game called A Fistful of Gun. And it's a co-op Western top-down shooter, which is coming out next month. And it features 9-player co-op.
I'm watching this trailer.
While you
talk about it.
Well, you go right ahead.
Are we gonna watch this?
Sure.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay, and ready, go. Folks, here we go. Oh, 8-bit style, I love it. I have a bone. Why 9? Guess who's getting that next month when it comes out? Shit! Oh man, I don't even.
I have one thing to say about it.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck yes.
Yep.
Fuck Yes. Okay, I am all about Western stuff. I love Western shit. And 9-player co-op top-down shooting? Yeah.
By the way, you can pre-purchase this right now on Steam for 25% off now. I'm very close to clicking add to cart.
Take my fucking money. Yes. Yeah, I can't say any more. It's being released September 24th, so it's less than 3 weeks away from its actual release. Mm-hmm. And from what Stefan said, you're going to be getting a discount if you pre-order it, so you ought to play with Stefan and I. We're probably going to be playing this game. Fistful of gun. Yes.
Yes. I'm thinking about going to be purchased this right now.
But congratulations, ladies and gentlemen. You've actually listened to our very first on-stream purchase of a game. I might actually have to go to Steam and look at this myself. This is what these games do to us, folks. Like, we're in the middle of a podcast, and we don't even care anymore. This is Fistful of Fucking Gun.
Yeah.
Fistful of Gun.
Yeah, let's go.
But, we have some Kickstarters.
We do have some Kickstarters, and I am pre-purchasing the shit out of that. okay, we do have some Kickstarters. Let's see. First one I got here, there's actually some very, very, very nice... Oh, I'm loving this again, by the way. Infinitrap. It has 26 days to go. It's looking for $5,000. Only has 3 backers so far. This is apparently a fast-paced puzzle game made for hardcore players. And hardcore only.
Oh, this is a funny looking. How many ways can you fucking die?
Yep. I would say that this is going to be a very difficult game for sure.
I'm not exactly sure if I would call this fast-paced, though.
Really? Is it time-based at all, or...?
I'm not entirely sure. I don't think so. But... the amount of, I think it might just be like the amount of stuff that's coming at you.
Mm-hmm.
Might make it fast paced. Like you have to duck underneath the fireballs, and oh god, I got killed by a buzzsaw. Mm. I gotta start over. Now I gotta jump over those fireballs and duck underneath those arrows and duck underneath that buzzsaw. Oh shit, I got blown up by a fireball again.
Fell into acid. Oh no.
Yeah, that.
So yeah, it looks like a very interesting game. It actually does look like he moves a lot slower than what I figured he would.
Yeah.
But,
it might be, like, fast paced might just be, you know, when you get to later levels and you have, like, 60 things to fucking dodge at once, you know? Maybe that's when it'll be fast paced.
Well, I mean, think about, like, harder levels, and they might, you know, end up putting in more later as well, apparently, so... Right. But, I mean, think about, like, ice levels. And stuff like that, like,
jeez.
Yeah, so, moving on to our next Kickstarter we have here. This is a non-linear exploration RPG called A House of Many Doors. They've already reached their goal. They were looking for £4,000. They got £5,100. 455 backers. Still have 27 days to go. And let me tell you, this game... looks very interesting.
I have to actually see what it's about, because I haven't actually loaded this one up. Explore the House, a parasite dimension of cities and secrets, a non-linear exploration RPG for PC. Huh.
You basically have a whole crew of people on this, like, bug type, like, centipede ship, and you fight other centipede ships. It's almost like FTL, but, like, in the ground or something like along those lines, it looks like. So it's really cool.
That's different.
Mm-hmm. I like it. I like the very old style graphics for the map. Fucking love it. Like, it reminds me of, like, Windows 3.1.
Right?
So basic, yet it looks good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely different. Like you said, like, the combat between, you know, these, like, little centipede things looks very much like FTL, so...
Yeah.
That'd be interesting.
Hmm. So, yeah, and, it doesn't look like they have too much to say about the game yet. Only backers can post comments. That's nice.
Right. We want to sing your praises, man.
Let's see. Okay, here we go. Here's the campaign stuff. Yeah, they've got a... Okay, they have a lot more there than I expected. Let's see. If you pledge £500, you get all the previous awards. Listen to credits as associate producer. They will work with you to create a character with your face and name. The NPC can join your crew, making them one of the most fully fleshed characters in the game.
Well then.
The character will also have your biography. They will be you. If you were stolen from Earth by the House, I will work with you to ensure that this NPC is as accurate to you as possible. Their dialogue will reflect exactly what you would say and do if you were transported suddenly and inexplicably to a nightmare dimension. Oh, you would not want to hear what I would have to say if that happened to me. I would imagine I would be quite the fucking Sailor Dan. Jesus. So, yeah, it looks like a very interesting game. If just go and check out, again, anytime we do these Kickstarters, we want you guys to go over and look at the Kickstarter pages. Maybe you're in your car and you're just driving and, you know, you don't have access to, you know, go and check the internet. Or maybe you do and you're one of those drivers who do that. Stop. Stop doing that. Stop. Put it down. Jesus. Just look at it after or wait until you get home or wherever you're going. But yeah, look at these Kickstarters, because you might want to look at some of the gameplay, some of the trailers, and see what these are. I mean, it's already, you know, fully backed, and it still has 27 days to go, so that should give you a little bit of input and thinking, like, okay, a lot of people are obviously interested in this for a reason, so let's go have a look. So, okay, the next one I have here...
This one is... Oh man,
it's fucked up and weird, but
this is clever. This game is very clever.
It is. They're looking for $6,668. They're looking for $8,000. They got $6,668. They have 49 backers, 20 days to go, and the game is called Kill the Plumber. Basically, you're the enemies from a Mario game. Or sorry, you're the enemies from a certain type of video game, and your job is to kill the plumber protagonist. So you're the antagonist in the game, kind of. So basically, you have to kill this plumber character so that you can finish the level. And there's several ways that you can go about doing that. It's a lot like... Imagine playing Super Meat Boy, but instead of controlling Super Meat Boy, you could get to control the traps.
Yep. This is actually kind of... I'm trying to remember the name of this game. Shit. Deception. We went over like a Deception game a couple weeks back, but... Deception's basically about, like, setting traps and making sure that, like, the NPCs fall into it and shit like this. But this is just... Clearly, it's based on Mario. And clearly, it's like, you are taking the other side of the coin.
Yeah.
You are now the bad dudes, and it's your mission to kill the plumber. So...
I think it's very interesting. It looks like it'd be a super fun game. I would definitely play this. I would definitely get this on Steam and play the shit out of it.
this looks pretty fun.
Oh, they're giving you 100 levels to start with.
Jeez.
Grassland, Dungeon, Castle, Beach, Underwater levels, over 30 different playable characters, recorded speedruns, controller support, multiple ways of beating levels, and even exploiting.
Huh.
If stretch goals are met, more will be added.
Yep, and these guys they're only looking for $8,000 for development. They're already, like, almost the whole way there, so they have 20 days to go, and this is another one of those I think you guys should just at least go and take a look at.
If this isn't made, I'll be actually disappointed. I have a feeling that this would be something big that people would like. Like, you could give the, you could put this on, like, Android phones or something if you wanted to, and I can guarantee you that people would eat this up. It looks very cutesy, but, like, still looks like it's hard, and I like it. It looks so good.
It does actually look pretty neat.
It looks like it would appeal to a lot of people.
And a $5 donation towards their Kickstarter gets you the game when it's released.
Jesus. So you're looking at, like, what, a less than $10 game anyways, so...
Yeah, so what do you got to lose?
And it's already been greenlit on Steam?
Yep.
They got through the process in about 5 days. We got the go-ahead within 2 weeks. Holy shit! Oh, this is gonna be so awesome! I can't wait to play it!
Kill the plumber, folks. Kill the plumber.
Indeed. Okay, so yeah. Two more Kickstarters left. One, the next one's gonna be called The Dwarves. Okay, so, check this. They're looking for $260,000. They've already got 123,000, almost halfway already. They've already got 2,554 backers and still have 33 days to go.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like it's going to be incredible.
It kind of looks like Diablo, but it's like there's a lot of dudes on the screen.
It's like Dynasty Warriors meets Diablo.
I cannot explain it any better than that.
Apparently, it's putting dwarves front and center in our new RPG with physics-based combat and an intriguing story. So yeah, I guess it is, like I said, a lot like Dynasty Warriors. Whoa, that was a... That elf was very close to that dwarf's face.
The animation that they're using is...
Oh yeah, everything looks nice. That overview of the map...
Yep.
That looks fucking really nice as well. Almost a lot like Civ.
Yep. Just a lot of stuff to do.
Yeah. So yeah, this looks kind of good. I like this. I can see why this has been getting a lot of attention. Shit.
Learn about the coolest fantasy race out there. Explore a huge game world with ever-growing group of companions. Experience an epic story with many optimal side quests and tough decisions. Discover unique traits about 15 different companions and improve their skills. Fight against hundreds of enemies in epic real-time battles that combine dynamic action and tactical depth. So they're planning on releasing this in mid-2016 for PC, PS4, and Xbox One.
Hmm.
Yep, but if you're looking for the PC version of it for the $20 donation,
yeah,
it's already gone.
Oh wow, shit.
500 backers.
And their special edition, all gone as well.
Yep.
Like the early bird special edition, I should say.
People are looking forward to this, apparently.
Wow. Oh shit, what? Okay. I thought these were people who were working on the game. I was like, wait, there's no way that they have these people working on the fucking game. Do they?
Damn.
Because if these people are working on the game, then that's fucked. There's no way. There can't be.
Somebody I should know?
Well, let's see. Brian Fargo worked on Wasteland 2 and Bard's Tale. Let's see. Max Schaefer worked on Diablo and Torchlight.
Jesus. Yeah. Okay.
Bjorn Pankratz worked on Risen and Gothic. I probably should know what Gothic is. And I only recognize Chris Conte because of his Satellite Rain lead designer. That was a game that was recently released with Satellite Rain, and that's gotten pretty good reviews as well, so...
Okay.
Well, yeah, I assume that those people aren't... If they're working on the game, that'd be fucked. But, yeah, anyway, sorry. But yeah, crowd combat, that's gonna be... That looks fun.
Yeah. And then they have, like, designs of what some of the characters are gonna look like, and they look very, very... very intricate.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even, like, the gross-looking guys, like, they look gross for a reason, you know?
Yeah.
Eye bulging out and all the fat over
his neck and shit? Yeah. Gross.
So, yeah, that is called The Dwarves, a new story... That's the trailer. It's called The Dwarves. So.
Whoa, so they have a $3,500 tier where you get your portrait in-game and in real life. You also get your quest in the game and quest designer credit. And then you get everything from the collector's edition, which has a shit ton of stuff. They're like, wow. Okay, you get to meet the team. You get, like, exclusive books and mugs. A dwarven stein that has a lid and stuff on it. Shit. That'd be awesome. I want some more. Have it constantly filled with rum and coke forever. That'd be awesome. Oh no, I want a rum and coke. Okay, anyways, moving on to our last Kickstarter. This one.
Yeah, this one.
Oh, okay. They say it best in the very title at the bottom of the Kickstarter, which is an 8-bit side-scrolling maritime adventure. Metroidvania meet Sid Meier's Pirates. It's called Leventerra, Tale of the Winds, by Lasso Games. They have 16 days to go, which makes me kind of sad. They're looking for 25,000. They have less than 5,000. They only have 136 backers. But let me tell you, go watch the fucking trailer right now. Pull over on the side of the road if you're in your car again. And go and watch the trailer for this game, and then tell me that you don't want to play it. And then come to me so I can slap you. So I can say, why the fuck would you not kickstart this game? Look at it. Look, the fucking game! It's so good. Oh, I want to play it so bad. Like, it really does remind me of, like, an NES game when I see it. A little bit faster, I thought, but I mean, still, like, a lot of it just, feels so NES.
Oh, yeah, it does. I mean, you got that Castlevania feel, you know, with, like, the way that the characters move, and...
Oh, like...
You got the pirates part where you're out on sea, and you're blowing shit up with your...
And there's, like, all kinds of different places where you're fighting and stuff. It looks like it's a big game. Yes, download the demo? Oh, don't you dare. Oh. Okay.
Guys are looking for 25,000. They're only at 4555, and they only have 16 days to go. So,
yeah.
If you guys use this, go over and check out this. It's Leventerra, Leventerra, Leventerra.
And again, this is why I'm disappointed that Kickstarter does not have PayPal. Right. I would totally back the shit out of a lot of these games. I just don't believe in credit cards, honestly. Don't even ask me why. I don't have a credit card, good reason, because I don't want to bother with that shit. But
no, I don't play.
There's times that I wish I had one just for this kind of stuff, because I would back this game so fast. This looks like a game I would want to grow up with in the fucking 80s. I would play this every day. It looks so good.
It does, honestly. And you've got, like, trade and everything like that, and... Ugh.
You find different islands, and if you've pledged $1,000, there's 10 people that can pledge $1,000 and create their own island. So you can explore this island and have side quests and stuff on it. So there's actually a chance of 10 extra islands being added to the game, thanks to backers, if there was ever anyone nice enough to do that. Oh, please, some... Oh. I don't know. someone really, like, this has to happen.
I mean, it's just this.
I want it so bad.
It's very wow.
It is, yeah. It looks so good.
I mean, for. We say that a lot about a lot of games, but this game looks very wow.
Yeah. Like I said, like I'm actually more disappointed that I couldn't grow up with this game.
Right.
Okay, so thus ends another podcast. Hope you guys enjoyed. It's a shorter one this week. Ooh.
Oh no, we didn't talk your ears off for 7.5 hours.
Yeah, I'm sure you're disappointed. But anyways, again, thank you all for all the support. And again, keep coming with comments, likes, subscribe, all that good stuff. Scott has a channel too, by the way. Scott Devin Kane, that's his channel name. Go find him over there. Go subscribe. Go watch his content. Go watch him pee his pants by playing like Five Nights at Freddy's or Clock Tower or something.
Clock Towers.
So, anyways, as always, thank you all for watching and or listening. I'm Stephanie Old World Gamer along with Scott Devin Kane, and we will see you all again next week.
Take it easy, folks.